الصلاة هيا على الفلاح هيا على الفلاح الله أكبر الله أكبر لا إله إلا الله
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهدي ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وعظيمنا وحبيبنا محمد رسول الله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. أوصي وأوصيكم بتقوى الله. قال تعالى أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم لقد أرسلنا رسلنا بالبينات وأنزلنا معهم الكتاب والميزان وقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم زن وأرجح زن وأرجح. أما بعد, it is related that Jibreel عليه السلام descended from the heavens to Prophet Nuh alayhi salam and presented him with something. Presented Prophet Nuh alayhi salam with what is called the mizan, the scale, the balance. And he said to him, Mur qawmak, instruct your people يَزِنُوا بِهَا, to measure with it. And then that was the introduction of the balance or the scale being presented to humanity. And this is one of the explanations of that ayah in Quran and Surah Hadid where Allah Ta'ala said that we have sent down messengers, لَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلَنَا بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ, with clear evidences, mu'jizat, miracles, clear signs. وَأَنزَلْنَا مَعَهُمُ الْكِتَابِ, and we've sent them with the book. And the mizan. And the scale. In other words, the scale, the balance came down with the book. The book is the guidance of Allah Ta'ala. The mizan, the balance, is the instrument to extend that guidance, to interpret that guidance. But it has two references. One is to a physical instrument that is used to weigh and to measure so as to prevent discord and disharmony and to empirically demonstrate justice and fairness amongst people. And without that empirical standard, without that scientific standard, there would be no baseline. There would be no standard by which or according to which people could use use to operate and to trust one another. And so a physical instrument was introduced, the mizan. But as an extension of that physical instrument is an abstract instrument that is created by Allah Ta'ala solely for abstraction. And the mizan is not only the balance of the scale in the physical measurement sense, but the mizan also means the aql, the intellect, the mind, an abstract faculty with abstract purposes. And the purpose of this mizan, in the sense of the aql, is to assess what is fair and just at the intellectual and the spiritual level, both in terms of the conduct of one person and in terms of their interpersonal conduct with another and across society and even institutionally. What is fair? What is just? What is balanced? So Allah Ta'ala said that this came with the Rasul, the prophets, the messengers. They brought the physical standard and the intellectual standard, because we know the aql refers to the intellect, but also the intellect has two parts, not just in the intellectual quotient sense, but also the spiritual intellectual aspect as well. They brought that standard also. لِيَقُومَ النَّاسِ بالقسط, so that people may judge or be judged with qist, i.e. adl, adl, with justice. That balance, that mizan, in the material sense, is just an introduction. It's just a principle, a tool, where people can see if the two parts of balance are equal. That's the baseline. That's the starting point. If you don't have the mizan, you don't have balance, you don't have justice, you don't have anything but chaos. So that was the introduction to Prophet Nuh alayhi salam. And it was passed down from one prophet to another prophet to another prophet. The kitab, the mizan, the kitab and the mizan, the kitab and the mizan. The book and the instrument to be just with the book. But when it came to the Prophet ﷺ, Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, there was an additional piece of that was added. And it's also mentioned in the Quran. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَأْمُرُ بِالْعَدْلِ وَالْإِحْسَانِ. You can have justice, but there must be something beyond justice called ihsan. And that peace is what we must strive for. Jabir ibn Abdullah radiallahu ta'ala, he explains that he went to the Prophet ﷺ and he purchased something from the Prophet ﷺ. As was the normal purchasing method, there were the two sides were measured. فَوَزَنَا بِهَا. So he put them on the scale. And the exchange was made. The Prophet ﷺ paid him for that object. He saw the price and its equivalent. Because in those days they dealt with equivalents. And so Rasulullah ﷺ paid the equivalent. That was the balance, that was the mizan, that's the adl, that's the justice, equality, equal for equal. He paid it, ﷺ. And then after he paid it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he gave a little extra, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jabir relates that he paid, and then he أرجح. And then he increased it. يعني gave a little extra. The Prophet ﷺ introduces the habit to the Ashab of going beyond justice into the territory of ihsan or beautiful altruism. Altruism. Going beyond just justice. There were two men that came to the Prophet ﷺ and they wanted to purchase something in his presence as he observed them. And they each, one of them, brought their specialist in the scale. So the hadith is narrated in Tirmidhi. And the Prophet ﷺ, he says, weigh it. And they weigh, and they put the equivalent on both sides. And then Rasulullah ﷺ sees the equivalency, and he tells each representative from the scale, who owns and operates the scale, he says, Zin, weigh again, just for short, wa arjah. And add a little more. Don't just pay the equivalent, pay the equivalent, and add a little more. And it gives to the person its equivalent price, but then pay a little extra, give a little extra, challenge yourself to rise above mere justice, mere transactions, into virtue and altruism. That is called irjah or ihsan. Many times we speak about justice in our communities, adl, referenced in the mizan, but very few times do we ponder about the ihsan part of that. The adl part, the justice is the baseline. But without virtue, without altruism, extra giving, enhanced refinement in our character, justice becomes eroded. And we find ourselves and we find our communities and we find our countries in turmoil and strife when it comes to matters of justice. How did we lose justice? There's no concept of mizan. No concept of adl or adana anywhere. Where does this extremism come from? You lose justice when you lose ihsan. When you lose altruism, when you lose that concept of irjah, because it is through that extra giving, it is through those, in the Quran, another Quranic term, the ma'un, those subtle pleasantries and gifts that make our relationships with each other a little more special. Rather than just dealing with each other on transactional terms. Eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth, this is the price, that's it. No giving on the part of the creditor to the debtor. No forgiveness. No extra generosity. Because the absence of those components of ihsan that begin to cause an erosion in our display of justice. Because if we don't rise above just transactional relationships, we don't do that, then what happens is we become victims of our own nafs, because the nature of the transaction is that we want what that equivalent is because of our own selves. It's my right to have it. So the nature of adl is based in a type of selfishness. Though it is commanded to be just for the sake of justice, but yet there is an inherent type of selfishness in that. When we rise above that selfishness and we transcend into selflessness, that's when we enter into the domain of forgiveness. and altruism, giving and loving, being merciful and kind, turning the other cheek, preference and deference to others, which is called ithar, preferring for your neighbor, for your brother, for your sister, over what you prefer for your own selfish gains, because you know that through giving you receive. That is what is beyond justice. The baseline is justice and fairness. That's the starting point for our communities. But for many of us, that is the goal. And that is the wrong type of thinking. That's the wrong type of paradigmatic thinking. The proper paradigmatic thinking is to begin with adil, with justice. Because Allah Ta'ala, inna Allah ya'muru bil adli. He starts by commanding with adil, so you start there. Wal ihsan, and then you rise and strive for ihsan, for irjah, for ithar, virtue, preference, deference, altruism. And that is the way that we curb, slowly but surely, extremism. There are two types of extremist tendencies that come from a selfish quality out of a false sense of justice. The first one has to do with viewing justice and acts of justice and transactions, viewing that as the norm and the standard and no deviation. Viewing constants as constants with no exceptions. An unwillingness to look at exceptions, an unwillingness to forgive in the pursuit of what is right in your eyes and my eyes only. In the pursuit of our own right. In other words, when I claim my rights all the time, then when I claim my right all the time, inevitably it leads to an excess transgression into your rights as well. Because my rights are afforded to me based upon my responsibilities to you as well. And part of those responsibilities that we have with each other is not just rights-based, but also responsibility-based. We share in giving and taking, not just taking. For if everyone were to take, then as the Prophet ﷺ said, we would claim and take the lives and the blood and the property of every single person. But when do we give? So that's one side where we see that the only thing constant are constants, my rights. We don't see the exception. We don't see that those rights exist in a symbiotic relationship of responsibilities and virtue as well. And so it is the nafs desire to pump itself up and inflate itself with the pursuit of what other people, or the pursuit of how much we can amass our own rights at the expense of other people. And that's one extreme. And the other extreme is when we see the exceptions to as the rule. We don't view the constants at all. We just see the variables. We see the exceptions. We want no rules and no standards. We want the way life to be the way that we want it to be. We want our rules to be the exception that becomes the norm. And many of the ulama talked about the fact that the Sharia is the middle ground between both of those extremes. And actually in the fiqhi, shari sense, when there are two opinions on a given issue, there's always a stronger opinion and there's always a slightly weaker opinion. That strong opinion is always called the rajih. And the weaker opinion is always called the marjuh. And the rajih opinion comes from that hadith earlier that I mentioned, where Jabir ibn Abdullah said, radiallahu ta'ala, went through that transaction with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he paid sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the price, wa arjah, and he increased it extra. Yet he gave extra sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told those men, arjah, give them extra. Give extra. And the rajih opinion in the Sharia is the opinion that is not just based in an adl opinion, but goes beyond, is layered in virtue and altruism. It's not just an opinion of rights. It's not just about hukuk. It's not just about adl. It's an opinion that has adl and ihsan wrapped in it, that has justice and rights and virtue and beauty in it. That's the rajih opinion. The opinion that has extra in it. And that extra is beautiful and conducive for consumption. We have to be people of irjah. People who always in our transactions with each other, in our dealings with each other, individually, with our family, institutionally, in our own businesses, find moments where we gift to others on account of the gifts we've been given. For if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala were to deal with us based on the standard of amal, we'd be dead a long time ago. Think about it. If Allah ta'ala were to deal with us strictly on the basis of adl, not out of the basis of rahmah, but just adl, what we really deserve, we'd be gone a long time ago. It's the hadith of the man who worshipped Allah ta'ala for 500 years. Allah gave him 500 years life. And in that 500 year period, he worshipped Allah ta'ala, did ubudiyyah to Allah ta'ala, without any ma'asi, any sins that he was aware of. And he's resurrected in the presence of Allah Ta'ala, and Allah Ta'ala says to him, "Udkhul Jannah bi rahmati," enter Jannah by my rahmah, according and from my rahmah. He says, "Ya Rabb, I worshipped for 500 years. I'd like your adl. I'd like justice, some equal compensation. I'd like to be judged, Ya Rabb." And Allah Ta'ala said to him, "So as long as you want to be judged, فَالْمُحَاسِبْ, we'll take you to account." And he brings forth the mizan. And the malaika gather out. And Allah Ta'ala puts the man's 500 years of ubudiyya on one side of the mizan, and it weighs down the scale. And the malaika say, "Ya Rabb, وَتُبُرْهُ عَبْدْ نِعْمَ الْعَبْدْ, Ya Rabb, take him." And then Allah Ta'ala takes the man's eyesight and he puts it on the other side of the mizan, the other side of the scale, and it outweighs the 500 years of ubudiyyah, because the man, he never once thanked Allah Ta'ala for his eyesight. Not once. The malaika said, 500 years and you don't thank Allah Ta'ala for your eyesight? What a kafir! What an abd that is a rejecting servant, ungrateful servant of Allah Ta'ala. Ya Rabb, take him to Jahannam. That his absence of shukr for 500 years outweighed the presence of his deeds. And what he didn't do was more of a crime than what he did in that case. And the man said, "Ya Rabb, Ya Rabb, I want your rahmana." Allah Ta'ala says, "As long as you want..." rahma, udkhul jannah bi rahmati. Enter jannah through my rahma. Nobody is in good standing with Allah Ta'ala just because of adl. If we deal with people and each other just because of adl, with no rahmah, no ihsan, no ithar, no irjah, no altruism, no virtue, no kindness, no mercy, those things are absent, and we just become robots of rational justice, we become agents of injustice. And that's what we see. And when we compete in excessive injustice, out of an effort to strive to reach justice. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ said, none of you will enter Jannah just because of your deeds. He said, not even me. Except under the condition that I am enveloped in the rahmah of Allah Ta'ala. And he cried, ﷺ. He cried. If we deal with each other just based on transactions like we're objects, so how can we expect rahmah from Allah Ta'ala? Allah doesn't deal with us just with adl. So he commands that we do the same. And when he revealed the mizan with the anbiya, he revealed this balance. That's what it means. Justice with rahmah. Aql with qalb. Mind and spirit. Law and ethics, science and morality. That's who we are. Our baseline is justice, but our bar is ihsan, irjah, extra, altruism, virtue. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to rise as we live a life in bowing and falling to Him. Ameen, Ya Rab. الحمد لله الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أوصي وأوصيكم بتقوى الله قال تعالى إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد اللهم اهدنا فيمن هديت وعافنا فيمن عافيت وتولنا فيمن توليت وبارك لنا فيما أعطيت وقنا شر ما قضيت إنك تقضي ولا يقضى عليك إنه لا يذل من واليت ولا يعز من عاديت تباركت ربنا وتعاليت فلك الحمد على ما قضيت نستغفرك ونتوب إليك وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم عباد الله اتقوا الله إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون أقم الصلاة.
الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن